So what I'm going to do now is talk to you about four of our programs. So specifically, these are going to be MSc Healthcare Management, MSc Public Health and Health Promotion, MSc Health Informatics, and MSc Health Data Science. So I'm going to give you an overview of these subjects. It's by all means not going to be a massively comprehensive dive into them. So if you've got any questions, we can answer them. And then I'll just give you a very brief overview of the other postgraduate subjects that are available within the faculty. So our entry requirements are listed here. I believe, because it looks like the presentation that I updated earlier hasn't updated. So I think the Nigeria requirements are slightly incorrect on this slide. So what we'll do is my colleague Toby will be able to provide in the comments what the accurate requirements are in the chat, so you'll be able to see them. We can come back around to that at the end of the talk. So to go on to the course information. So we'll begin with MSc Healthcare Management because it's one of the more popular programs within our faculty. This is a course intended for people who are currently actively engaged working within a health or medical field in their work. So they've either studied or they're working in that area. So it could be doctors, nurses, biomedical scientists, it could be dentists, someone working in complementary medicine, a whole range of diverse backgrounds to do this course. And what people typically are coming to do is to study a management program because they either want to become a manager within their field of expertise, or they're looking to move into perhaps a national or even international area where they can diversify out of that specific subject that they studied in. So the way this course works is instead of going to do, a standard like MBA or MSc management course, it employs those techniques that you would find within a management degree, but is focused on health and medical provision around the world. And if you're coming to study this with us, you will be looking at working with students from a wide range of countries, so it's one of our biggest programs internationally. And you'll be looking at comparative global healthcare. So how does the National Health Service in the UK compare to, say, a more private healthcare system within the United States, compared to maybe somewhere like Saudi Arabia, which is a very cash-rich country because of the oil reserves that they've got? And you're looking at how they would manage that healthcare provision in a really wide range of areas. So what you do is you need to bring your expertise, whatever your background is, whether you're a physiotherapist or a heart surgeon. You bring that expertise, and what our team will do is teach you how to take your existing skills and look at management and leadership techniques. And you'll look at that on a local scale, a national scale, and an international scale as well. And the way we do that is it's via five core modules and then a range of optional modules that you're able to do. So you're looking at things such as a theory and practice in leadership and management in health and social care, politics and policies, organizing healthcare, social, cultural, and economic context of healthcare, and then evidence of research for healthcare management. And what you'll notice in this, politics and policy is always quite important because any healthcare provision is very much determined by what funding is released by the government to be able to allow you to carry out your work, to be able to support people across different communities. And then what you'll do is four optional modules. So looking at things such as quality improvement, psychology of healthcare management, economic evaluation of healthcare, and foundations in public health and primary health. And you would choose two of those optional modules. And that would feed very nicely then into your dissertation, which is a 20,000 word piece of independent research that you would do, tying together all of these techniques that I've just mentioned from those modules to what your existing or previous career was in health or medicine to sort of neatly marry those up. So that's a very brief overview of healthcare management. What I'll do now is I'll move on to our MSc in Public Health and Health Promotion. I'm just going to have a quick look at the poll and see. Yep, so it seems like the majority of you are here for Public Health and Health Promotion. So this course is mapped to the National Occupational Standards and the Public Health Career Framework. So what that means is when you come and study this course with us, on successful completion, you'll be eligible to apply for registered practitioner or specialist status with the UK Public Health Register. What that means for you is effectively there is some form of accreditation. It's not directly accredited by the course, but the course is mapped against those standards. So you can take your previous experience, marry it with the course that you'll be studying in Swansea, and apply for that the practitioner or specialist status to be able to work within a public health role in the UK should you wish to remain in the UK upon completion of your studies. Now, the big thing to flag up with this course, firstly, you'll notice a lot of the suitable for section is similar to that of the healthcare management program, but there's additional areas that are included in this. So things such as environmental health officers, planners, housing experts, food scientists, psychologists, sports scientists. And I think it's worth looking at those areas because the reason this course is quite interesting is it's not just directly tied to healthcare provision in terms of if you're a doctor or a nurse or, you know, you've worked in bioscience, because public health is in so many different areas of our life that sometimes you don't realize it. And the course is based on, it's not looking at just MPH or a master's in public health. It is public health and health promotion. Now, what our academics are very keen to stress is they don't think that this is better. They would never say, you know, it's better than an MPH, but it does offer you a different skill set when you do this program. And it's why we're able to open it up to those other areas. It's because if you do an MPH, you'll look at how you write a public health strategy. You'd be looking at the epidemiology behind things. How do you write a public health strategy? But they won't. What that course won't teach you is how to get the messaging out there from that public health strategy. So if you look at quitting smoking, it's probably a really easy example to do. If you want people to quit smoking because you go, well, there's an extra cost because smokers, you know, they unfortunately do get sick from smoking. So by being smokers, you want to encourage those people to quit. So you go, well, the public health policy is we want people to quit. So you write a plan, which is we want to introduce free nicotine replacement therapy. So anyone can go to a doctor or a pharmacist and they're able to get nicotine patches, nicotine gum, and that will help to get people to quit, which will reduce the strain on the healthcare provision where you've got to treat people for cancer treatments and things like that. So that's what you would potentially do within an MPH. What this course does is go, well, you've written that strategy, but how do you tell people about it? How do you get the message out there? How do you actually target your messaging so that current smokers know what the health risks are and what the benefits are to quitting? And how do you get them to know that there's actually a provision in place where they can access these nicotine replacement therapies for free, which they might not consider if they think there's a cost attached to them. So that's a really basic example of what this course does. And one of the key things really with public health is with your strategy for any country, you've always got to look at, you know, what's the provision, what's the funding there, and it varies from place to place. And this is a really diverse course with students studying from around the world. So similar to the way our healthcare management program looks at comparative healthcare systems, what the public health program will do is allow you the opportunity to speak to people from a wide range of areas. And what Ruth, who's the academic, the program director for this course, she'll say, public health always starts with two things. People need shelter and they need water. Those are the two very basic public health standards. Everything after that is a wish list to try and make people feel better, live longer. And so this course will teach you how to look at those public health areas and what you can work on within maybe a government area, within a localized area, within an international, working for a body like the World Health Organization. How do you take those different areas and how do you apply them within a health promotion aspect as well? The way we do that with this course, it's different to our healthcare management course in the fact that it's all core modules. So it's made up of foundations in health promotion, public health evidence and epidemiology, public health ethics, developing programs and evaluations, health protection, management and leadership for public health, and then foundations in research. So that's the seven modules, but you can see I've boxed off one extra module here, which is public health practice. Now, this is quite a big selling point for a lot of students that come and do the program, because it's an opportunity for you to look at how public health is implemented in the UK so you can compare it back to your home country. So typically, what students would do is go and do a 1 week observational placement. Now, because of what's been happening with coronavirus over the past year, our students haven't been able to actively go out and do an observational placement, but we've been able to help connect them to areas where they can at least have conversations with people, and they can take what their existing practices from their home country and have conversations with people in the UK to gain an understanding of how that public health provision works here, so they can put the two together. I'll give you a specific example because that sounds slightly vague what I've just explained to you. So a specific example for this would be we had a student who came from Nigeria a couple of years ago, and he wanted to look at public health and health promotion for snake bites in northern Nigeria in rural parts. So what I had a quite long conversation with him about this, and he was saying that farmers in those areas, they quite often die from snake bites. They're too far away from a hospital and they can't get the anti-venom to them. So unfortunately, people do pass away from this. So he wanted to write a public health strategy which would help to save people's lives. And then once he wrote that strategy, his health promotion was to get that out to the populace. So he went and spent a week visiting an anti-venom farm in West Wales, so about an hour and a half from Swansea, looking at how they produce the anti-venom. And most of the anti-venom for Nigeria comes from Wales, not far from Swansea. So he learned how they process those anti-venom doses, how they're stored, how they transport them. And he came up with a policy which was effectively the anti-venom's great, but really what you want to do is prevent people from getting bitten in the first place. So he wrote a health promotion strategy to be able to let people know in those rural communities how to prevent them getting snake bites in the first place. So that's quite a niche example. Obviously, it's not just all about snake bites, but I hope it gives you an idea of what the purpose of that module is and then how it ties into that 20,000 word piece of independent research. So I've got here just an example of a student that came, not from Nigeria or Ghana, but someone who came from Romania. She came from originally, and her background wasn't directly related to public health, but she wanted to transition into this area. So she came to Swansea to do the public health and health promotion course, and then because of that registered status she was able to get, she was recruited for a graduate scheme, I apologize, in health and social care. And now she's been able to go to London and work as a public health commissioner there. So the course really opened some doors for her. She's been able to remain in the UK and work here, and she absolutely loved her time in Swansea. You can read the words here yourself of how she found the course, what her favourite memories were. But I think it shows that this course does have quite direct application for you to be able to go on to find work in the UK after completion. So moving on, I'm just going to have a quick look at the poll. So we've got a few of you who are interested in health informatics. So our MSc Health Informatics program, if you've applied for it, you probably know what it is, but it's for people who come from a background of healthcare professional, management, technology, health information or data management, medical and clinical records, coding, ICT and computing, health and social, sports sciences, health economics, nursing, social work, care, business administration, management, statistics. You can see the range of areas. And it's usually people from either a sort of more health-based area or a more science and technology-based area, because it really does marry those two together quite nicely. And it is one of the fastest growing fields in healthcare. And the reason for that is because it's looking at massive amounts of patient data. How do you process that patient data? How do you analyze that patient data? Because all of that feeds into really the other two areas that we've talked about. If you want to look at how you evaluate healthcare with healthcare management, if you look at how you put a public health strategy together, to be able to do that, you need to have an understanding of what's going on with the populace. You need to be able to look at where patient records are. Is there a particular area where there's a spike in cases from people dying from something or becoming a bit sick from something? How do you evaluate what the inpatient journey is? How do you evaluate how they're treated? And that helps you to make healthcare improvements. So the way we do this is it looks at engineering information in healthcare systems and then utilizing that and managing that patient data. And it's an intelligent use of information and technology, and the ultimate end goal is better care for patients. So what we want is any patient who goes to a doctor a pharmacist, a hospital. We want them to have the best possible journey through that and to have a successful outcome to whatever they're going through, whether it's something quite minor or something quite serious. And what this does is it helps to look at analyzing on a big scale everything that's happening across healthcare provision, looking at state-of-the-art technology to provide that analysis, and then you apply that to be able to make improvements across the healthcare sector. So with our course, we have really strong links with the NHS and organizations across the life sciences sector. And typically students who do this course go on to do become an application developer, a data analyst, a data scientist, perhaps a project manager. They do go on to academia and they enhance career prospects and career progression. And you're looking at data, as I say, it's a wide range of data, looking at patient data, looking at call logs, looking at IT systems, looking at how we manage it, because there's probably still places where you just have filing cabinets full of people's information. That's obviously not the most effective way to manage a patient's journey. So how do you have the best possible systems in place to be able to assist them as much as possible when they need healthcare provision? And the way that we do that for this course is compulsory modules around health informatics and context, communications and coding, systems and technologies, knowledge management, using secondary health data, and then undertaking health information research. And all of this takes place in the newest building on our Singleton Park campus, which is our Administrative Data and eHealth Research Centre. So it's a £30 million facility that's been built specifically for health informatics and health data science. And it really is because of what takes place there. It's a secure building. You can only get in if you're on the list to go in there. And I think it's quite an exciting course because it really is. It's technology driven. It's up and coming, and it's something which, especially as you can see with what's happened with the pandemic around the world, patient data is more important than ever before. How do you roll out a vaccine if you don't know what's going on with your populace? You need to have that information to be able to make decisions as to who gets the vaccine first, how you distribute it, how you actually then manage who's had the vaccine, who hasn't. It's a really interesting course. I think it's quite fascinating, actually. And it leads quite nicely into our health data science. Now, I don't think anyone has said they're here for this. So I'll briefly just talk about really. This is the sort of sister program to health informatics. So it's the smaller version of smaller in terms of student numbers compared to that health informatics course. But by no means does that mean it's a lesser program. It's quite specific in what students want to do because it's looking at developing essential skills and knowledge required as a health data scientist. And it looks at the science and art of generating data-driven solutions. And looking at complex real-world health problems. So, as I've just mentioned, the pandemic is a really good example of a real-world problem where there is a lot of data that you need to analyze to see if things have been effective. It's how we were able to establish, whether we needed to go into lockdowns. And when in the UK they started looking at locking down in specific cities and regions, it's this data science area that helped them to make those decisions to be able to lock down cities and stop numbers from climbing. And it's how we've been able to have such a successful vaccine rollout in the UK. It's employing critical thinking and analytics to derive knowledge from big data, learn how to process health data and extract information about a population and the epidemiological applications of that, and to improve quality of life on a large scale. And ultimately, it's a better understanding of patient data. So, as I said, it's quite similar to what you're doing with health informatics. But you'll notice for the suitable four, it's very technology, science, mathematical focus because it is you're working primarily to become a health data scientist if you do this course. So, a strong emphasis on practical and analytical skills that are applicable in the workplace. And it's a data scientist in primary and secondary care, and to enhance career prospects for career progression. That's the ultimate goal of this course. And the way we do that is through compulsory modules of scientific computing and healthcare, health data modeling, introductory of analysis of linked health data visualization, machine and machine learning in healthcare. And then you choose one of two optional modules, which is advanced analysis of linked health data or bioinformatics for genome analysis. And then you would do a health data dissertation. And as with our health informatics course, this takes place within that state-of-the-art facility that's been purpose-built for that. That £30 million facility that I mentioned during the health informatics slide. So that's the sort of the depth of those programs, what I'll very briefly do is tell you just we do have other postgraduate taught master's programs. So under health, we do also have a long-term and chronic conditions management program. So that's for people who want to look at how you can help to manage people. Help to manage patients who have long-term or chronic conditions, so things such as maybe diabetes management, or it could be people who've got, heart disease, things like that, and how do you help them have the best quality of life going forwards? Social research methods. So this is again sort of data-driven, but by no means the depth that you would have for something like health informatics or health data science. It's far softer, more sort of the sociological aspects of looking at how populations live and work. Then you've got three childhood courses: childhood studies, developmental and therapeutic play, and child public health. You can see a range of psychology programs. What may be of interest to some of you is that we do have three medical science-based programs, so genomic medicine, medical radiation physics, and nanomedicine, which we're seeing an uptake of interest in that program particularly. And then finally, there's three courses that are blended slash online delivery. So these are programs that you would visit for the first week to sort of do your introduction to the course, then return to your home country and study them the rest of the duration online. And many students would, continue to work in their home country as they do this. We have a range of postgraduate research programs, which you can see here. You can see how some of these tie directly into those master's programs that I've mentioned. So things like analytical sciences, health informatics, health sciences, things like that. So they all tie directly. So if you were thinking of doing a postgraduate taught master's and going on that academic route afterwards, we do have a range of options available for you to do that. And now on to scholarships and funding. I can see, sorry, I could see that someone raised their hand. I'll answer any questions at the end, but by all means, you can put them in the Q&A, and my colleague's going to answer them via typing if needed while I just finish the last few slides. So for scholarships and funding, so if you're applying for Nigeria or Ghana, you will receive an automatic Thrive bursary. So you would have seen the tuition fees on all those slides as I was going through. So you'd have a £3,000 automatic tuition fee discount. Or you can apply for the International Excellence Scholarship. So if you go onto our website, you'd need to complete an application. Typically, students need the equivalent of a 2-1 or above to be eligible for it. And you need to have an offer to your course to be able to apply for that scholarship. And if successful, it effectively tops up that Thrive bursary by £1,000, giving you a total of £4,000 discounted off your tuition fees. Some of you may also be eligible to apply for the Ira Francis Davis Scholarship. So this is a full tuition fee scholarship for female applicants from low income or low middle income countries. What I should note is one scholarship is offered per year. So it's a highly competitive scholarship that, that people apply for. And you must hold an offer for one of our postgraduate taught master's courses within the Faculty of Health and Life Sciences. The deadline is the 1st of June, and there's five questions you need to answer. What I would advise is if you are considering submitting an application for this, you really take your time to answer those questions in as much detail as possible. We want, really a breakdown of everything, your whole thought process, why you found Swansea, why you're applying for your course, and it, as I say, one scholarship awarded a year, so it really is the top candidate that gets that scholarship. We have some upcoming events which I'd encourage you to attend. So there's a range of academic-based webinars which we're calling our Head Start series. I've included a few here that might be of interest. You can go onto our website, you can see the link here, or you can just if you Google Swansea University Head Start webinar, it'll come up as the top search. And you'll see that we're constantly adding to this. I've included, as I say, some subject headings which might be of interest to you, but there really are a lot of topics there, and we keep adding to it all the time. On the 23rd of June, we have a postgraduate virtual open day. This is a really good opportunity for you to actually meet the academic staff. So the program directors for these courses will be there. They'll give a much more detailed talk than I am now about their subject, and they'll be able to answer a lot more questions about the course as well. And we also do one-to-one meetings. So should you want to book a meeting with me directly or with my colleague Cecilia, when we send a follow-up for this, we'll send you an option that you can book a calendar request, and you can have a one-to-one session with us to have a chat if you have any questions that weren't covered in this talk or the open day itself. We do also have an English language school that's accredited by the British Council, and they offer a range of programs, ranging from quite short programs to full semester courses in English, should you require them. Now, this is a really good option if you hold an offer for the course, and there's a requirement for English language, because due to the coronavirus pandemic, we're actually offering free English language classes to students. So you can go on and you can book one of those sessions and do your tests online. It's the equivalent of an IELTS test, but it's called a SWELT test. And if you meet the conditions for your offer via that SWELT test, you are then able to meet the terms of your offer and study with us in Swansea. What I would say to you is, if you've already met the conditions of your offer and you've already got your English, do not sign up for the classes. They are only for people who haven't met the conditions and they need to meet that English requirement, and it is free of charge. That's the main thing to note. So if you are do have an English requirement, you can sign up for this and have a free test online. Just to tell you a little bit about blended learning. So in terms of the way we've delivered the programs for the past year, so we had a September and January intake in Swansea for many of our courses. But because of COVID, we haven't been able to have the classroom environment that you can see in this image, where everyone's sitting next to each other. So what we've done is a online blended learning delivery, which means that students can access Canvas, which is the online learning tool, and it's via Canvas that you would access your timetable, and you would be taught via a range of lectures, seminars, which are effectively smaller seminars, group work with students, one-to-one sessions with your academic mentor, and then independent learning as well. And many of the sessions for the courses are live, although they are online, but they're recorded, which means you can go back and access that material again. So we've had students who have said for the past year they've actually found it quite useful, because if there was something that they couldn't quite understand or they missed something, they can just go back and watch the recording, and they can rewind it and watch it as many times as they like to really, understand what's being explained to them. What we hope for September, obviously everything is dependent on what the government policy is going to be at that time. We hope that there may be some on-site delivery of classes, but by no means can we promise that, because it very much is based on Public Health Wales and the UK government's guidance at that point. So I would anticipate there will always be blended learning at some point over the next year or so. So don't anticipate that, you're going to be back in classrooms full time. We hope that there may be some on-campus delivery, but still anticipate that online learning that you would need as well. We have a range of student support, and these range from the academic mentors. So if you're not familiar with that term, an academic mentor is a member of our academic staff who teaches on the course that you're studying, and they are there to help provide you with guidance on any of your assessments, if you don't understand anything, and really to make sure you get the most out of your degree. So they're there to help sort of iron out any creases you may have in your knowledge. There's a range of support, ranging from sort of disability support and equality and diversity champions, mentoring, money advice, the International Development Office. We've a team called International Campus Life who are there to support with your visas, student advice services, counselling. We have something called the Swansea Employability Academy. So they are there to help you find volunteer opportunities. They can help you find work part-time while you're studying, and help you to find work if you're looking to stay in the UK after completing your course. And then we have the Centre for Academic Success. And this is really something which I would advise any student coming to Swansea to make use of, because this is how students get the best possible grades. Because there are a team of people there to help you with everything from essay writing, referencing, academic writing, critical thinking, presentation skills, all of the things that you need to get the best qualification when you come to study with us. So the academic mentor's there to help you with the subject knowledge, but it's this team of people who are really there to go, well, you've written this essay, but this is how you can improve it by changing the terminology, by utilizing different words. They really are an excellent resource, and the students who utilize them really do incredibly well in their degrees when they come to study with us. Just to touch on accommodation very quickly. So we have accommodation available across our Singleton campus and Bay campus. Now, you're not restricted to stay on the campus, the accommodation on the campus that you're studying at. So should you want, you could live on the Bay campus but study on Singleton Park campus. And the way the accommodation works is it's a cost of around £90 per week to around £200 per week, we'll say. The reason for that cost is it's a bit of a staggered amount. So the lower you amount you pay, the more people you share with, the more you pay, the less people you share with. Now, I should be clear of that doesn't mean you share a room with someone, but everything is split into flats. So you would have your own individual bed space and a shared kitchen facility. The lower cost rooms would have around 14 students living in a block. They would have one toilet per two bedrooms, and then they would have 14 people sharing that kitchen space, which is your kind of communal area to socialize. The more you pay, the bigger your personal room gets, and the smaller the amount of people you need to share that communal area with becomes. So at the top end of the scale, you'd be looking at eight people in an apartment block. You'd have your own ensuite bathroom and shower facility, so kind of like a hotel room, a bigger room to live in, and of course, only eight people would be utilizing that kitchen space. We are able to make certain concessions if people request them. So, for instance, if you wanted a alcohol-free dorm or you wanted a female-only dorm, we would do our very best to accommodate that. What I would caution with that is, say you you wanted a female-only alcohol-free dorm and you're at the lowest cost, that's 14 people would need it. If you're the only person, they're not going to make 13 other people share, that specific criteria with you. It is on the basis that other people want a similar thing, but they are pretty good at accommodating your needs at accommodation. So, yeah, just if you get in touch with them, they would be able to help you with that. We're coming very close to the end now. I can see a couple of questions are popping up. I will come to them once we finish this, and we'll bring in my other colleagues as well, so you haven't got to just listen to my voice. Don't worry. So student life, so we have something called the Students' Union in Swansea University, and these are students that are elected to represent you, represent the student body. So they range those elected officials. There's a president, and there's people who represent different areas such as sport and equality and diversity and things like that. And as part of the Students' Union, they would arrange social events for you, and there's a whole host of student societies that you can sign up for. And these cover everything from a culture, language, hobbies of film, music, TV shows, sports of football, swimming, surfing, rock climbing. We even have our own Quidditch team. So if you want to grab a broomstick and run around the campus, you can. You'll see someone occasionally in a golden outfit dressed as the snitch and people chasing them all over campus. It's quite funny. So there's a lot of cool things you can do like that. Obviously, our campus environments, we've said, right by the sea. This picture is taken directly in front of the Singleton Park campus. And then you have something called Discovery, which is an opportunity for you to do volunteer opportunities as part of your studies as well. And that is it for me. So what I'm going to do is stop sharing my slides now. Should you have any questions at all, please get in touch and I'll be happy to help.